How many of you are at the size of 10 people right now? Can I see some hands in the air? Okay. How about 20 people? 30 plus? Okay. A bunch of everyone. Any missed hires so far? Any problems on the recruitment side? Not so many, a bit. Okay.
Always.
Always. I'm asking those questions because I believe this transformation from 10 to 30 people and more is very crucial for companies like you. The way you used to do things is not exactly the way you do them now. People may stop knowing each other. Sometimes they don't really know what's expected of them. And recruitment, it's more problematic than it used to be. It takes a lot of consideration to decide who should be invited to the company and who shouldn't. And I came across those problems a bit in reverse, going from more than 30 people to 20, and then again to more than 30. I took over as the CEO of Ragnarsson in 2013, when our founder, Łukasz, passed away. It was one of the biggest crises we've ever had, but we survived. And I believed we managed to do so because of our strong company culture. And even though I say it was strong, it was far from perfect. Łukasz was the only person in managerial role doing anything from administration to hiring and sales. And as you can imagine, he was a huge bottleneck. People didn't really always know what was expected of him. If he stayed in touch with him, that was possible, but it wasn't possible for everyone. Also, many of our employees, they weren't even able to tell him many times how the company was actually doing and where we were heading. And when it comes to recruiting people, only Łukasz had any clue. The rest wouldn't know who would be a good fit for us and who wouldn't. So when we lost him, it was obviously a challenge in itself. But on top of it, one of my biggest fears was that our culture is going to rapidly deteriorate and it's going to be very problematic for us to survive in the long run. One of the first things that we did, and when I say we, I mean my business partners and a bunch of volunteers that really wanted to improve how the company worked inside, we started drafting a list of desired behaviors, a list of beliefs that we had, something that would be the foundation of our culture, something that it's explicitly defined, and because of that, it's easier to follow. As an example, one of our values is openness. We work in projects with our clients. Usually we help them on the software side with building different kind of software as a service solutions in online marketplaces. And as you can imagine, in software developments, there are always problems. So instead of hiding those problems and trying to push the blame on somebody else, we want the team to be always open, with clients and say, well, guys, we made a mistake, we underestimated something, let's find a solution together. Those kind of behaviors should be present at all the projects that we have, and we should have consistency. Now, getting back to our values, we actually came up with five things that were the most important to us. And we described it with four simple sentences to make it a bit easier for the team to understand. Now, instead of going to the team and saying, guys, this is our new belief system, please follow suit, we really wanted to engage the team. We were around 30 people back then, and we were a remote first company, so it was a bit difficult to organize. We split the team into 5 or 6 groups, and we had a conversation with them for 2 to 3 hours. We were supposed to do the homework and engage with the discussion, what they think about their values. Is this is something really that they see it's happening at the company? Maybe something should be added, or maybe we actually behave differently. And this is not really true, what we have here. And to my surprise, people were really prepared. I'm saying to my surprise because imagine software engineers talking about their emotions and values. But this is exactly what they did. They really engaged. And because of that, they really owned what we created. They really owned the outcome. But also, what we gave them was a new perspective, how they could be looking at the company. And I remember this conversation I had with one of our team members. He told me, listen, Maciek, well, actually, this, you know, being passionate about things, it's not really what that happens all the time. I mean, sometimes we just have stuff to do. We just need to finish it. And nobody is super excited about it. I mean, is this fine? Is this, is, you know, how we should think about it? So this new perspective, they realized that those values, those belief system that we have, it's a perfection that it's difficult to reach every minute, every day, by every time, everyone, but by the same time. And it's fine, we're just human. But as long as we strive to be this kind of organization that we want, then it's great. I have two examples for you, how we incorporated those beliefs, because once we created the draft, the second fear that I had was, well, this document, it has a high chance of dying and being buried down on our Google Drive and nobody will ever see it again. So we incorporated those beliefs into our processes. And the first example that I have for you is from our recruitment process. When we hire people, we assess three kind of things: general fit, technical fit, and culture fit. General fit is more or less, well, what are you looking for? Well, this is what we offer. There is a fit, more or less. Technical fit, well, we're looking for software engineers with Ruby skills. Oh, you have Ruby skills, we check them. Great, there is a fit. Now with culture fit, it's a bit more tricky. We engage, this is the last stage of our recruitment process, and we engage up to 10 people on our side. Everyone has a 30-minute conversation with every candidate. Those calls are one-on-one. And the goal for it is to make sure that the candidate believes in the things that we believe as well, that our values are actually aligned. As an example, when it comes to growth, it means that we don't ask direct questions like, well, would you like to develop new skills at our company? Obviously, the answer would be yes. So we ask a lot of indirect questions about the past. As an example, well, maybe there is a book that you would be able to recommend me that heavily influenced your thinking recently. Or maybe there is something that you've done in your professional or private life that changed the way you do things or maybe think about something. And this is how we try to better understand what actually people value and if they fit to our company or not. Now, on the side of the team, this process is really great because they have a tool, they have a guideline that they can use to evaluate people. It's much easier for them to engage as recruiters. And also they're constantly being reminded of our belief system. They use the values to evaluate others, so it's really difficult to forget what kind of behaviors are desired at the company. And now, once we decide to hire someone, there is an onboarding process. We spend a whole day introducing each person to the company, as one of the main points is actually an intro to our values. And as you can imagine, nobody remembers anything from this day, and especially not the values. But in the long run, once they engage as recruiters, once they engage in different parts of the company, they think like, they were those values. Now I understand why you mentioned them at the beginning. Maybe I don't remember the details, but they're in general, they're more likely to use them on a daily basis. That was the first example, pretty obvious, how the guidelines could be used in a process. And I have another one for you, which is at least in our case a bit extreme. It's about promoting people and exchanging feedback. In our case, well, we actually let people to set their own salaries. I know it's a bit extreme, but for the sake of the argument, it doesn't matter that much. The only requirement that people have before they set their salaries is meeting in person. We do it twice a year, Again, we are a remote first company, so it's better for team bonding to really meet as long as there is no pandemic. And we spend the whole day sitting together and exchanging feedback. And at the end of the day, everyone is able to set their salary. Now, this is an example of how we sit in a group and exchange feedback. And obviously, we would like to avoid situations when two buddies from one project, they sit together and say, "Listen, mate, I think you're a great guy. You should be definitely making more money." We want to make the process more meritocratic. That means we use our guidelines, we use our values as a tool for self-assessment and assessment of others. And actually, on this picture, you can see me holding a piece of paper with our values. So usually it goes like that. Well, when it comes to growth, I think you've done great progress. I can really see how you better communicate with our clients. I can see that you're able to tackle problems that you weren't able to tackle before. On the backend side, you do this and that, and this is really great. Well, when it comes to your openness, I can see some shortcomings. There were some frustration before that you had about the things that we've done, and you didn't really say anything. I mean, I understand maybe you didn't like to do so, but on the other hand, we weren't able to collect feedback, so we couldn't improve the process, you know. Maybe this is something that you could reflect on. Again, on the team side, it's super valuable because they have a tool that they can use for self-assessment and assessment of others. They're constantly being reminded of the desired behaviors that we would like to have at the company. And also feedback, even though it's not one of our values, this is still something, this is an important part of a super important process at the company. It means that people do it over the course of the year because they know that this is something that the company wants them to do in different forms, on different occasions, but still it reinforces that the feedback flows. Those two examples I gave you relate more to the guidelines, to the values, whatever you call them, that we have. And we quickly realized it's not really enough. When you think about the self-setting salary process, this is a distributed decision-making process. And we quickly learned, well, this is really great. We can really speed up the process of making decisions. We can really move forward faster. Why don't we use such mechanism in other places of the company? But before that happened, we needed two things. We needed to have a clear set of responsibilities, a clear structure who is allowed to do what. And second of all, we needed to provide people with context. And I have two examples for you how we did it. When it comes to delegating responsibility and splitting those responsibilities among the team, before that happened, it was actually a mindset problem for myself and my business partners. I wasn't an especially controlling person, but on the other hand, I wasn't super relaxed about letting people making whatever decisions they would like to make. And I believe it's a bit counterintuitive for leaders that they would be held accountable for the decisions that somebody else is making. But I also realize it's inevitable in the long run if we want to scale, and I wouldn't like to be the bottleneck. At the same time, I thought, well, we have really talented people at the company. Why don't we just trust them and see what happens? So once I overcome the mindset problem, we focus on the structure. We really needed to know who would be responsible for what, and we created a document which gathered all the responsibilities that we had at the company. We grouped them into roles, and we assigned those roles to different people. This is an example of a set of roles of mine when it comes to our fund. As an example, I'm a later stage analyst, and I make decisions if we invest in something or in a startup or not. Obviously, you could be saying, well, you're the CEO, so obviously you would be making these decisions. But in practice, any other person could have those roles assigned. And then they would have authority over making this decision. Now, the key things to remember from this example is to have some kind of a structure defining who does what, and at the same time, not to intervene as leader, not trying to take control over the responsibilities that you defined. If you do it, you will undermine the whole structure, the whole document, and it's not going to make any sense. Now, I've been talking about making decisions. People set salaries. I decide if we invest or not into some companies. But how the hell people actually make those decisions? And I believe that in many cases, founders make the most important decisions and the highest amount of decisions because simply they have the highest context. Obviously, there are other reasons, but let's focus on this one. The highest context means they are able to get information from many different sources. They have many perspectives that they can use to look at problems. And because of that, well, hopefully, but it's not always the case, they make better decisions on average. So we quickly realized if we want to delegate responsibilities on people, we simply need to provide them with as much context as possible. And sometimes it wasn't easy to tell who needs what kind of information in what kind of circumstances. So by default, we simply open up everything that we had, from simple things like changing our Slack channels from being private to being open, opening up documents on Google Drive, for instance, access to OKRs or roadmaps to some research that we've done. And we even went to the extreme, something that it's not really popular in our industry, at least, but we shared all the financial data with our team. And here you can see an example of a budget, of a monthly budget that we have. Every employee is actually able to see the details behind those numbers. So they can see how much everyone is making, how much I'm making, how much our clients are paying, how much we spend on different things. And I believe this financial perspective is super crucial in many decisions. If we didn't share this data, many times I could imagine people would come and say, well, you know, we have this idea to do this and that, but we need this kind of budget, we need this kind of money. So basically I would be responsible for the decision anyway, because they wouldn't have this financial context. Now, the key things to remember here is to open up as much information as possible. Really, at least from my experience, most of them are not as crucial as you may think. And second of all is to have this clearly defined structure that I described in the previous example. To sum it up, in order to create a strong foundation for the future, we realize that we need to really know who we want to be. And once you know, it's much easier to get there. If you want to be athletic, you need to work out every day. It's as simple as that. So if you want to become some kind of an organization that you defined, you need to be doing the heavy lifting every day and incorporating it into your processes. But in general, it might not be enough. It's great to have some kind of structure that supports whatever you want to achieve. And you need to provide people with data, with information, so they could be making educated decisions about all the things at the company. And it sounds super simple, it sounds easy, but actually in practice it's much more messy. You define something at the beginning, then you start doing things, then you realize something is not perfect, maybe you need to tweak with your guidelines, the kind of your ambitions, then you again implement something. And I believe you're not really able to define it at the beginning and then forget. If you're a small company, it's a bit easier to define it with 10, 20, or 30 people. It's more difficult to convince 100 that we want to be some kind of an organization. But it's possible. Anyway, the amount of changes that you make at your companies, the more you make them in time, probably requires more frequent a review of what you have in place. And that was all I wanted to convey today. Thank you so much for listening, and I'm happy to answer all your questions. Do you still hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. Wonderful. Thanks for the presentation. Really, really good. And really, I think it was up to like how you say it. Like it's absolutely honest and really, really on the point. So thanks a lot and very practical.
I have a
question on the behaviors you showed in the beginning.
Yep.
So you have the values and then you showed the behaviors. How did you come up with those behaviors? Is that from the leadership or from the founders or from everybody? And how do you decide what is a value and a behavior for the company and what not?
Yeah, that was a bit complicated. At the beginning, it was just a mess. So we had a list of behaviors that we really, that we are doing on a daily basis, and that we wanted to make sure that they happen. So this example with being honest with clients was a good one. Also, one of the behaviors was to always try to deliver high quality. All the people were really, really passionate about what they did. As you can imagine, software engineers talking about those nitty-gritty solutions that they built, but sometimes it doesn't connect with the business model of the company and what it actually wants to achieve. So by just creating this list, and then we were trying to group those things into something that made sense. But we made it in a small group because it's more difficult to discuss it once if you don't have anything to show to the team. So we did this draft and then we discussed it broadly with the entire team, and then we changed the draft and came up with the final version. But it was a process. It must have taken months to finalize.
And did they agree, or I suppose there were people who were saying, no, we don't like this behavior, or how was the process? Like, did everybody say, oh, wonderful, you did a great job, or how was the reaction?
I mean, at the beginning, it was a lot of confusion. What is it? Why it matters? And I would say that people with some people that were, let's say, more attached to the company, they understood what was it about. For some people, it was more like a leap of faith. But in general, the biggest concerns were when people noticed that this is not really something that we do on a daily basis. I mean, not in every case and with every value, but sometimes they could say, well, maybe 50% of the people do it. How we should think about it? So they realized it's more of a, we kind of realized during the process, it's more of a North Star. So if 50% do it, maybe it's not perfect. Maybe we can go to 70%, but we shouldn't expect everyone to do it at any time.
I have a question.
Yes.
How frequently do you do all the exchange feedback to reevaluate salaries? And do you only exchange feedback in those moments, or do you have any other moments throughout the year set? Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Sure. When it comes to the process of setting salaries, we do it twice a year. In the pandemic, it also worked online quite well, apart from the team bonding part, as you can imagine. But then we exchange feedback on the other levels as well during the year. So we have one-on-ones with people. Everyone has one person assigned, and we do it on a monthly basis. And also, at least with software development, the culture of exchanging feedback is quite good, because anytime they release something, and it could be even every day or even a few times a day, depending on the style of a specific team, when they deliver a bit of a code, then obviously the other team members review it immediately. So this is more like a low-level feedback, and then they have retrospective every once a month or every few weeks, depending on the project. And then they talk a bit more high level about those problems. And then even more high level with during one-on-ones, and even more when we do it twice a year with the entire team.
I've got another question. Thanks so much for, great presentation. I was just wondering, in terms of like being very transparent about financials, how that changed as your company started growing, started to scale, because you mentioned that you first started off with a smaller company and then you built up to like 30 employees. It went down again and then you went back. Did you always maintain this transparency, or did you face any challenges by making all the financials transparent from day one and then also throughout the growth phase of the company?
Mm-hmm. So we released the budget 7 years ago when we were more than 30 people. Then we had a crisis after a few years, then we went down to 20, and then we are back at 30 something. The problems related to transparency are the ones that you wouldn't probably expect. So some of them most of them are related to our salaries, but not in a way that somebody else is making more money than I do and they do the same. No, when people are on the same level, they are super mature actually to position themselves among other people. So in many cases, there are no really conflicts saying, oh, this guy took too much money. Maybe it happened once over those, we started doing so in 2017 or 18. So we had 6 or 7 sessions so far. Most of the problems that we have is because when the salary is there are no cases when somebody, because when salaries are close, there might be exceptions that somebody is making more money, because in order to keep them at the company, the founder said, well, you could be making more, but just please stay. So we don't really have those cases. So everyone is well positioned among each other. And that also means that when we get candidates from the market, sometimes their expectations are really out of the blue, are still something technically within our range, but they're desynchronized with what we have inside. Because in many cases, those people who are seeking for better job opportunities and higher salaries, they were able to exploit the situation in their companies and getting more money than everyone else. And then they expect it from new employers as well. So this is like one of the problems when everything is open. But any other problems, not really. So if I make the most amount of money as the CEO, nobody has any problem with it. I mean, if I were making, I don't know, 10 times more than the second person or something, then probably that would be problematic, but that's not the case. So most of the problems are related to recruitment and the expectations of the candidates.
Yeah, maybe thanks for answering the question. Maybe just a follow-up, because salaries are only one side of the coin, right? How about stock options? Is that also something you make very transparent, that every single employee knows who the owners of the company are and who owns what proportion of the equity stake?
So we don't give any stock options. We are not really a startup. In our case, it doesn't make much sense if you look at the rate of growth. When it comes to knowing who owns what, from what kind of shareholders do we have, then it's also open. It's also open what kind of dividends we have. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Thanks for clarifying.
Any other questions?
Maybe I'll jump in. I have a question on diversity.
Yep.
And thank you for the presentation. I was wondering, on the hiring process, you say you have a part of cultural fit. And I was thinking, you mentioned the books and those questions, but do you include like a diverse mindset where different like perspectives might also add value? Or do you try to follow the same reasoning of thought and backgrounds on the company?
And you mean diversity in terms of like having more women on board, or just a different kind of
mindset? More in the mindset, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's an interesting question. Usually when I look about the diversity of the company, we have two types of people. Someone who is going to be more engaged with our internal matters, someone who is really going to be helping in all things that we do internally. So for instance, be active in recruitment, be active in solving different problems. We really rely on the team to help us with building our processes and not only working in projects. So usually some of the people are more willing to engage on different fronts, and other people, they just would like to be in this project and focus on it solely. So it's not really like a mindset of a diversity of mindset in terms of, I think differently than you, like everyone thinks differently to some extent. But I'm not sure if we have like a specific criteria to select specific people. Most of the people that we hire are software engineers, and they're not so diversified, I would say. We focus on a few different markets. Most of the people are from Poland. We also have some Ukrainians. We're also looking at different markets, but in practice, it's difficult to, for instance, have more women. There are simply not so many women applying, not so many candidates on the market with skills that we're looking for.
Thank you. And maybe just a follow-up question.
Yeah.
You mentioned questions regarding books. Just wondering other questions that you ask on these cultural parts.
Yeah, one of my favorite one is when it comes to engagement. So we really wouldn't like to have someone at the company who blames everyone around for the things that didn't happen. So for instance, well, I'm leaving my company because they promised to do this and that, and nothing happened, and this is important to me. And then I ask questions, why nothing really happened? What was the problem? What did you do to really have it in place, to implement it? Was it within your reach, or the boss said, well, we are not doing it? And then in many cases, I realized this person really did nothing apart from complaining. Maybe that's a bit too harsh, but still, they either don't have the skills to introduce changes to the company, or they don't understand the broader perspective of why their proposal doesn't make any sense, or simply, yeah, they expect others to be fixing those problems.
Thank you.
Maybe a last question on the decision framework. When you let others, when you give responsibility to others to make decisions, in the end, you are the CEO and one of the founders maybe. How do you deal with that if they come up with decisions that you like personally wouldn't support, but then this trade-off to correcting it or to just let it go to keep the framework alive? How do you deal with that like struggle?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, in practice, sometimes I don't like certain decisions, and depending how important it is, I engage more or less. So if we say that we decide to, I don't know, change something in our recruitment process and it's not super severe enough, not a deal breaker, then I just do nothing and they do whatever they want. Sometimes when we have higher level decisions, like for instance, we switched to English a few months ago, and we had a discussion if we should be hiring people who don't speak Polish, because then we could open up ourselves to much more candidates. You know, for some people it was problematic because everyone likes to speak in their native language. For others, it was fine because they wanted diversity. But it wasn't that clear. And as a leader, you can always influence people when you state your opinion, saying, well, I would do this because for me it makes sense because of those three reasons. And many people, they expect to be pushed in a certain direction. They actually need someone who would be saying stating their opinion, so it's easier for them to make up their mind. So maybe I'm not taking control and saying, now we do this and that. But when I say things, it can influence a bunch of people and then steer the conversation into a certain direction. And it happens in recruitment a lot. When I mentioned that we have up to 10 people on the third stage of our recruitment process, sometimes we had cases when, I don't know, 8 people said, yeah, this guy is great, 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 great. And I was at the end and I said, no way. but not in a sense, I disagree and we are not hiring him, but my opinion about this person is this and that. And then suddenly half of the team changed their mind and we end up not hiring this person. So this is also why I try to state my to voice my opinions at the end, not to influence people at the beginning. So I didn't take control over the decision-making process, but I heavily influenced the outcome, which is also not always great. Maybe I may I have a question to you? Like on the around the things I described, what are the biggest challenges on your side? Not everyone at the same time. It's difficult to understand.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello, I can share. Hi, I'm Tina from Maze. I think one of the big, we have a very similar structure. So we have set the values. There are 5 to 7 values depending on seniority and they are decoded into behaviors. So I think one of the main challenges for us, and we're a small team, is to make sure that feedback is given based on those behaviors, not to be like something subjective, because if we do assessment semester or quarterly, which we do, it's not as frequency as needed to make sure that those behaviors are embedded in the company. And so I think, so one of the challenges is to make sure that the framework of feedback works in a way that reinforces the behaviors that we want to nurture in the company and to avoid those that we don't.
Okay, so leveraging the guidelines, the values that you have in many other places so it sticks.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. I think that's one of the main challenges.
Got it. Anyone else that would like to share the challenges?
Yeah, maybe we can share some quick insights. So Arpita, please jump in if you want to add things. But I think personally, the challenge to convince our colleagues or like employees in general to really focus on the benefits of defining values and also be very committed to the company culture is just really, I think, bandwidth constraints that people always have to follow so many tasks and things are always a priority one, priority zero, so many deadlines are coming up. And then whenever you want to try and engage with people and convince them about the importance of being aligned on the different values and different morals, I think, yeah, people are just not really interested because they know that they'd rather spend this time on work and deadlines. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I think that's one of the challenges that we're currently trying to overcome mm-hmm. as an organization.
Somebody wanted to add something?
Yeah, sorry, just to add to what Dom was saying, we also have a lot of people coming in from different organizations. So there's already culture they're like carrying in as well. So being able to merge all of that and have the same value system that we have had up until now is also something that we're hoping to be able to continue. And we're trying to figure a path out for that as well.
Got it. Maybe to add something to what you said. In our case, it was a bit in reverse. So we put a lot of emphasis on building the foundation, so that the culture, discussing the values, making meetings and so on, and not so much on the business sales and KPIs that you need to deliver every now and then. So it's, I would say it was the example set by us as owners, as leaders, and then people, if we said, you know, guys, this is important, this is not anything urgent, this is, you're not going to see the results tomorrow, but it's still it's important for a long-term survival, then they understood. But the example was set at the top of the company, but obviously you need to balance the two to really able to stay in the business. So I feel you. I understand it's not so easy to do so.
Can I comment on that?
Yep.
This reminds me of a talk that we had here in MazeX with the HR of OutSystems, which is a unicorn here in Portugal. And mm-hmm. one of the decisions that they made as they grew, and now it was like thousands and thousands of people, was to separate the discussion about values and behavior and culture from performance. So that those conversations are never held at the same time. So obviously when people do the reassessment to review salary or promotions, the two conversations will inform this decision. But the moment that people are discussing either giving feedback or making sure that the behaviors for each level and each function are working properly, that's one conversation. And then in terms of OKRs fulfillment, it's another conversation, which might seem a little bit confusing, but in the end, allow them to have more rational conversations and nurture the development of employees instead of being a big mess. So I thought that was an interesting distinction.
Okay, so the way I understood it is a bit like with OKRs. So you have goal, you have objectives and key results measurable, but on the other hand, you don't evaluate people based on those objectives. Okay. Yeah, in our case, I think the belief system is that the financials are just kind of like a side effect of us being strong, but it doesn't matter that this problem of making money is going to solve itself. Yeah, it's just a matter of balance, of putting effort into both activities.
Hi, I have a question. Really good presentation. Thanks for this. It will be really, really helpful. You said that you involved everybody in the definitions of, the values, well, mm-hmm. all the growth and everything. And I was wondering, who did you involve and at what stage? Because like, were you involving everybody from the beginning or it was at different stages? Just, yeah.
Yeah.
Who and when actually?
Yeah, the first draft, it was a small team, because once you have some kind of a draft, it's easier to talk about it than when people need to come up with everything from scratch. And then when we engage everyone, we did it in groups. So 5-6 groups, a call for 2-3 hours. They were supposed to do the homework. So make the exercise, helping them to reveal their own values and also review what we created. And then during the call, I was moderating, I probably all of them or most of them. And I was really trying to get everyone's opinion. So everyone should say something at least for a few minutes, even if they agree with others, just to say that they agree or not. And then after this process, we gathered everything, we gathered feedback. And then we spent a bit of probably too much time to really create the final version, because one of the challenges is to really find a good way to present it. And we copied what Netflix did. They have this nice presentation about their culture. And also when you look at their values, they have something similar. So a bunch of values described in short sentences. At the beginning, it was more descriptive. For instance, what Zappos did is more descriptive, saying this is the value, and then a bunch of paragraphs explaining it. But for us, it didn't really work. It was too much, too vague. So we stick with this one.
And regarding the groups of people, were they composed of only one team? So you mentioned like the software engineers, or was it like groups made of software engineers, people from marketing, et cetera, like people who have worked for several years, people who have just started? I was wondering, yeah, how?
Everyone, and I kept referring to software engineers because simply this is the most of the people are software engineers, but yeah, everyone was involved. That it didn't really matter if someone is in marketing or not.
Right.
It was actually helpful, because then we would be talking more about like general concepts and not something that only applies to development projects. Anything else that you would like to share? Okay, so one last maybe question from my side. Which part was, let's say, the most interesting for you? The most relevant, maybe? Defining the values, incorporating them, or the structure for decision making?
Well, I think both. It's difficult. Like for me, I think those were the two main parts.
Okay.
Maybe the examples, I think, from the like the behaviors and the example that you mentioned and how you're doing it at your company, I think that was the best, like the most interesting part.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, Christoph. I would say the structuring part, because as Christina said, at Maze, we already have the values quite aligned with what you told us about. So I think it's, yeah, the rest.
Got it. Okay, so at the end, I have a bunch of useful links for you. Everything that I described, if you need to get more details, probably everything that I said is written somewhere in those articles. Also, feel free to reach out if you have more questions. I'm happy to help. And that's all from my side.
Cool.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Have a great day. See ya.
Have a nice day, everyone. Thank you for joining us.